Well, welcome once again, brothers and sisters, to the YouTube messages. I'm Evangelist James P. Gribben, and it's our privilege and pleasure to bring teaching on this YouTube. We do go out and preach the gospel. You must be born again. You must repent of your sins and turn and receive Christ as Lord and Savior. Be born again, a new creation. And after that, it's a wonderful life. But there are dry spells. There are periods where you might be confused. There are periods of digging and searching and wondering. That's okay. What straightens the whole walk out is the Word of God. Jesus said that His Word was a lamp unto our feet, a light to our path. Then He said this remarkable statement, "Ye are the light of the world." So our walk can be a lamp also, or shining like a lamp for others when they see how we walk, when they see how we love the Lord and that we're obedient to His Word and walk that Word out as best we can in obedience. And so the Word is so essential. On our tracks, it's been there some 37, 40 years. He sent His Word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. Oh, that men would praise the Lord. He sent His Word. There is no higher than the Word. And all the gifts and all the wonderment of Christ in His tabernacle, in all the glory, the Word is the undergirding for it all. If you have the Word on a topic, a subject, on a question, you will not be deceived. Now, in the last time, there are many deceptions. And we read one or two of the last lessons ago that 2 Peter, I believe, there would be false prophets and teachers among you. That wasn't going to be just a fact, it was a promise. And of course, it will be, or the Word of God is not correct. And the Word of God is always correct. Though men wrote it, they were just a pen in the hand of God. God wrote it. God was instrumental in the entire Word of God. You can trust the Word. And this is why we keep saying in our messages and so forth, are we in the Word? If when that is put to you, you can say, yes, I remember that. Yes, that's the Word. And have your Bible at home to check out what's being preached. And if I will not give you the for reason and the for why and so I preach and such, you need to get away from this preacher and the YouTube. But if we bring to you and another set of scriptures bring deeper revelation and a deeper walk in obedience and love to Jesus, then you're listening and following the right thing. The Apostle Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. He meant in the Word. As Paul walked in the Word, you do also. And Paul would be the example that a man can follow Jesus. A man and a woman, a boy and girl can follow Jesus. Follow me as I follow Christ, he said. And I've been doing that. I think people call me a Pauline. I've been doing that for years, following the Apostle Paul. But of course, underneath all of that, behind that, back of that, side of that, on top of that, I'm following the Lord Jesus Christ, my Savior, and the one whom I worship, the one whom I live and breathe to please. Jesus is the answer. So in these last days, there's going to be these false prophets, false teachers. We dealt with the thought on heresy and adultery. The adultery gets three corrections and then put out from amongst. The heretic only gets two, showing how quick the poison runs through by action and by mouth and explanation. The poison. The physical adultery and fornication affects you and the other person. Perhaps it affects your family, your wife, and your relationship and your love towards God. It cuts that down. But you can't make others follow your example and fornicate. you can't make others follow your example and commit adultery. If it's not dealt with, they see that there's no power in the tabernacle. To go with one, go with two, tell the church, and then put it away from amongst yourselves. Now, if that's being done, you know the Word of God is being practiced. Now, over here, there's spiritual adultery. Many Christians don't know what that is. They just think of the physical adultery as dealt with in 1 Corinthians. Now, we want to lay a little foundation before we go on in with this Catholic Church message. We told you we preach in heresy. These four heresies. Number one would be the Catholic Church. We're working on that now. And so this would be perhaps part two of the Roman Catholic Church, the great harlot of Rome, the scarlet lady that sits on the beast, that rides the beast in the book of Revelation. Spiritual adultery. What is that? Well, this is what's wrong with the church. This is where the ecumenical movement comes from. And this is what will fold on over into multi-faith. The ecumenical movement opens her throat and spews out, not just worshiping with other churches and other Christian denominations and so on. It opens its throat and spews out multi-faith. They're coming together to worship as other faiths, including the Christians, the Jewish folk, Muslim, Hindu, Baha, and all kinds of faiths. So we're progressing real fast. It's not just churches that's off, it's churches that's coming together again. It's not just churches that's coming together, it's churches that's being enticed into the world church via the ecumenical door onto the platform of multi-faith. So you see, we have a lot to do, and you see that teaching is essential because the church has left all that off. It used to be in the Assemblies of God and the Church of God at the beginning, wonderful, powerful, living holy churches. Of course, God never formed a denomination, but He's gracious, he had to work with it, but he never formed those two denominations or all the other dozens and hundreds that have come out of that. No. In the early 1900s at Azusa Street, God never formed denominations. I have a lot I feel on my heart today, and I'll be moving fast, and a lot of scripture, and then a lot of reading, but it's got to come out of me. This is the accumulation of 40 years of tracking this woman they know in Revelation 17 as the woman that rides the beast, the Scarlet Lady, tracking her up through and into and beyond the Catholic Church. Now, praise God, we can dig in and get teaching, and we can be tracked and kept tracked. And so this end time is filled with false teachers and false prophets. And some of their teachings is just so diabolical, you wonder how people believe them. But they're brought along in what we call around here gradualism. It's given to you in portions, this false doctrines. Gradually, making gradualism. And the whole thing is to change your mind about what you were taught when you was a young Christian. To change your mind over to the way of the false prophet, which is based on self. Me, mine, us. The Christ walk is based on Christ, them, they, the people, the church, life. This is based on death. This is based on the glorifying of Jesus. This is based on the lifting up of man, such as the Pope, Kenneth Copeland, Benny Hinn. So all do follow, at least in some part, a man that's deceived them in promising riches, or a man that has the Word of God and promising them to die to self. Which will you choose? The riches, the false prosperity message, or take up your cross and follow me, says the Lord. So today, like the other lessons, you'll be brought in and out as the Holy Spirit moves and convicts and encourages. You'll be brought in and out in your heart and in your mind as the Spirit moves upon you, where and however you're watching. You'll be brought in and out of the thoughts. I've done that. I need that. That's been trying to influence me. Oh, I'm so glad I got out of that. Yes, my friend, you will relive some things as this lesson goes on. You will see some new things as this lesson is turned around into your path. So we're not to be with fornicators. We're to put them out with adulterers. We're to put them out of the church. For the Bible says, purge out the old man or the old leaven. Don't you know a little leaven? We're supposed to know. Leaven's the whole lump. Now, in spiritual adultery and fornication, don't you know, a little bad doctrine, a little twisted teaching, a little additive to it will deceive you. So we've got to purge that out too. Now, not to sound repetitive, but we've said most of the churches don't know what spiritual adultery is. And they feel great if they've actually attempted to put adulterers out of the church. They feel like a Hercules, and praise God they would do that. But the church is filled with spiritual adultery. And I want to lay this little foundation to show you that and what we're to do with that. And well, it's basically the same as the physical adultery. Put it out. And how do you do that? And who is guilty? Well, you see, if they brought another teaching from a clique, a gathering, a division, a disunion, they were called heretics. And after the second admonition, you were to put that person away. You couldn't fellowship with them. Now, this spiritual adultery is getting ascendancy, and we'll be reading a scripture in a little bit from Revelation where it shows you that the woman of this spiritual adultery is still alive, though this was wrote nigh on 2,000 years ago. 2,000 years ago, you say, and she's still alive? Absolutely. She appears in Revelation in red type King James English. She's in a church. And he's speaking about her, indicating she's doing it then. She's done it last period, this period, now and forever. Now, how could she do that without dying? It's spiritual, you see. She's dead already. Jezebel was chucked out of the window and the dogs eat her up, just as the prophet said. Jehu came raced across on the chariot across the desert floor and the dust steaming up. And she says, looking out the window, who is this that rideth furiously? See, Jehu was a man of God. And every man of God, every disciple of Jesus, male or female, ought to ride, believe, attempt, a charge, be charged furiously. You don't go up to someone and say, oh, would you consider possibly pray about might stopping your adultery with that strange woman? Oh, no. You've got to stop this adultery. You will be put out of the church. So it is with riding furiously. Jehu was the prophet, the man of God in the chariot. And he wasn't going to come up and say, would you consider putting down this spiritual adultery and the awful things you're doing to God's people? Just like this is what Kenneth Copeland's doing, deceiving God's people with promises of everything under the sun if you'll just go that scriptural way that he brings. But it's not scriptural. Though he quotes a scripture, when a man quotes you a scripture, it doesn't mean it's scriptural. Simply means he's twisted it round, ungreeked it, stitched a bit in and put it back together to make it sound scriptural. But it's just still a scripture twisted to suit his selfish purpose. So Jezebel looked at the eunuch standing beside her, and she sees Jehu coming across the desert floor miles out. the dust riding up in with the wind and Jehu's forcefulness of driving. Psh, psh. He's into it. He's coming as God's man to bring judgment. He's coming as God's man to correct things, to bring the just punishment as was prophesied. And there's some prophecies still left to come and to be passed on in the present that are frightening. And she was frightened when she seen this, riding furiously across the desert floor. And here he comes. And she says, what is it? Send an embassy out to make peace, make a deal. And out comes the man on the horse up to Jehu, and he's riding again furiously. He said, my Lord, is it peace? Well, you know, we teach never prefer peace over truth. That's deadly. But if you'll do the truth and claim it, you will have peace. Even in the most ferocious storm, the horseman rides up to Jehu. My Lord, is it peace? And just to quickly how he dismisses it. What have I to do with peace? As long as that woman is in Israel, here he comes now, screeching, the wheels turn up the dust, screeching underneath the window. And here she is, just like the church today, Jezebel. Here she is, tucking the hair up a little bit. Little kerchief and little makeup on, not preaching against the makeup kind of doctrine. As long as you're not dressed up like a Max Factor color card, a little bit of makeup and so forth won't put you in hell. Just don't change your entire appearance, as I've got made it. Anyway, she's getting herself fixed up and she's looking at, perhaps in her heart she's saying, oh, I still look pretty good. I've still got it. I can deceive this young buck. And he screeches and lands himself under the window. And there she is. But this man of God is there to bring forth the fulfillment of prophecy. Whatever God has said, he will do. You be very careful, your secret sin will find you out. And God can see in the dark as well as in daylight. He knows everything that's gone underneath your covers and who's in there under them covers. And so he pulls up underneath. Now, he didn't, like most preachers today, say, we found your walk, Miss Jezebel, very satisfactory towards the tenets and commandments of this church and what the elders believe and the deacons, the dead deacons and all, you know. He didn't do that. He just looked up at the window and he said to the eunuchs, he said, throw the old dam down. My goodness, she was took down a peg or two before she ever hit the dust. And then the prophecy was fulfilled. Because if she did, killing God's servants, using the signet ring, the seal, she's in the dust. Her body eat up, her blood licked up. And Jehu turns on to the next adventure. My friend, God can kill the devil anytime he wants. And this is the hour when he's not putting up with a lot of people that act like the devil. Spiritual adultery. Now, you'll see her in Revelation, yet it's being spoke of her as if she's just being turfed out the window now, because he's talking to her, she's alive in the spirit. And he's saying, he's giving her a space to repent, or he throw her into a bed of great tribulation, so she must be there, because she hasn't hit the bed of great tribulation yet. It hasn't arrived, but oh, it's coming fast. So what do you all think about that? God's having a conversation. She hasn't hit it yet, so she must be alive. Now, she's not back where she was. The dog's eating her up. She was pronounced dead. In fact, almost vanished. So how can that be? Not fully over here yet, a word about that, but kill the dogs, eat her up. What is the middle and the end of that story. But it's not ended yet. But that part did. What is it? She's alive and still serving her father, the devil. For he is a spirit too. No match for the spirit of the Holy Ghost and the Lord Jesus Christ. But praise God, these things are put into the Word to show us. Now we read on, and our first scripture here will be Ephesians and chapter 5. And we read a verse here in verse 11. Ephesians 5 and 11. Have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. Oh, she got reproved that day, all right. But more. She got the sentence as well. And more. She got the finish. When you reprove, there's an opportunity to make things right with God. Be it a sinner towards salvation or a saint towards obedience. But have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. Those that are practicing these dark things, these sins. And verse 7 says, therefore be not partakers with them. 6, let no man deceive you with vain words. Oh, is the church filled with vanity? Yes, sir. For because of these things cometh the wrath of God, like Jezebel, the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Twisting the scripture is disobedience. Living for yourself is disobedience. And it said in verse 10 then, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord, and now in the verse, have no fellowship. So the physical no fellowship in 1 Corinthians and in 2 Corinthians, they get put out. Well, what's the difference with the spiritual fellowship? In God's mind, they get put out too. Now, if Jezebel's alive in Revelation 2:20, he says, you sufferest that woman Jezebel to teach and seduce my servants. Do you know a church that has a Jezebel in it, teaching and seducing? Is she here physically? Is she doing that today in your denomination, in your church, in your society, in your fellowship? Well, if she is, it must be through teaching, because he said to teach and seduce. So, what is it then? Two components? Oh no, one. Making up, teaching and seducing. How does she seduce? With her teaching. Elementary, Watson. She does it with her teaching. And she seduces them. And God is not pleased. Now, we're going to go there in a few moments. But to reiterate in 1 Corinthians 5, 6, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. Spiritual adultery. Spiritual lumping. Verse 11, not to keep company. So how can you go into these places that pray to Mary, rosary beads, and they're Catholic, they speak in tongues, and they go to the ministerial once a month liars association, liars club. Because it's a lie as soon as they go in. They have made a pact not to reprove one another of their darkness. They just accept the darkness because it appears to them in their darkness that you've got more light than darkness. And after all, there's only poison in one piece of the pie, so let's sit down and eat the pie. Only one of us will die. Not so. It will spread like a contagion, like a false laughing revival from Toronto, spread into Pastor Sandy's church down there in London. And they went laughing and blowing and kicking and clucking and roaring like lions, and women falling down in a disgraceful manner, and everything there for everyone to see before the cloth hit her body. God isn't slaying people in the spirit and covering up their legs with cloths. That's a disgrace and affront to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's not in the scripture. It's modesty and covering our wives' bodies up, knocking them all down and blowing on them. And if that isn't spiritual seduction, I don't know what is. But it's a woman doing it. Because you see, a woman in New Testament biblical times, in the spirit life and world, the Word of God, she's always looked upon as the church, the body of Christ. She's called feminine, his bride. And it says, my bride has made herself ready, or the text, the bride. Are you part of the bride? Are you making yourself ready? Well, I'm saved by grace, I am too, so is John. So is Rebecca. But when he convicts us something, though we're still saved and saved by grace, the conviction we're applying to what has to be changed, because we grow, don't we, into more and more of the likeness of Christ. You know, you can't watch on television what you used to watch the first year you were saved. That's conviction. That's sanctification growing and deepening. So let no man deceive you. And they've got so many ways of deception. And Jezebel has to be dealt with in everyone's life. Just quickly, in marriages, most women wear the trousers or the pants, depending on which country you're preaching in, England or United States. They wear the trousers. And the man is afraid of them. He can't stand up in his own home. Well, so it is in the church. The sheep should not be afraid of the pastor or elders or deacons. The sheep should have the fear of God, not man. And the Bible said in Proverbs that the fear of man, see the opposite, the fear of man bringeth a snare. But whoso trusteth in the Lord, the same shall be safe. And so we can't get out of the path of the Word of God. Now, I want to go there to 1 Corinthians and read it from the text. So let's turn, I think, to 1 Corinthians. And I think we'll be around chapter 5. All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 5. We will read verse 7. Purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump. Verse 8. Therefore, let us keep the feast not with old leaven, the way we used to walk, that darkness, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. You have to be sincere and keep the word of God truthfully. I wrote unto you in an epistle not to keep company with fornicators, yet not altogether with the fornicators of this world, or with the covetous, or extortioners, or idolaters, for then must ye needs go out of the world. You can be in the world, but not of it. So we're not here to judge the world, but we're not going to keep company with them. Now, 11. But now I have written unto you, so here comes another letter, not to keep company with any man that is called a brother, if he be a fornicator, covetous, idolater, reeler, drunkard, extortioner, with such an one, know not to eat, have no fellowship. So you see, there's the physical and there's the spiritual. So now, the world, we have nothing to do with that. As the Bible says, love not the world, neither the things that are of the world. For all that's of the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father. And if any man loveth the world, the love of God is not in him. Though they may try to fake it, as they do regularly. So that physical, that world, and that lifestyle. Now he quickly switches in this verse 11 and changes to the spirit. But now I've written, oh yes, physical and spiritual. Now there is spiritual adultery. We're approving this just right now. But now I've written unto you not to keep company of any man that is called a brother, spiritual, be a fornicator, unspiritual, covetous, idolater, reeler, drunkard, extortioner, with such an one, know not to eat. For what have I to do to judge them out there? But do you not judge them that are within? And to cover that, they say, don't judge. When it says, judge not that you be not judged, he goes on to say, first get the beam out of your own eye, and then you will see to take the beam or the mote out of your brother's. It didn't say not to do it. It said, get your own out and not be a hypocrite. Get that in your eye out first. Then you'll see. He's recommending it. and they've twisted the scripture on 700 Club, the London Channel, God Club, TBN, all of these, judge not that you be not judged. It didn't say that in Matthew 7. It said, judge not with the measure you measure out. It should be measured back to you again. Correlating with the scripture, whatever you sow, you'll reap. So you mean if a truck's going to hit a man, you can't judge that and save his life? If a man is caught in physical adultery, you're not going to go to him and judge him and help him. You judge to help. It means as a judge putting on a wig to separate himself out. Its translation and its following through in the scriptures means censorious, lack of love, no compassion, final judgment. You don't judge a person as a final judgment. You don't judge them to be away with them. You don't judge them to put them in hell. You judge them to keep it out of it. To keep them out of hell. So the very thing they need, all them big ministers are saying, do not do this. Jesus said, do this. But first, get the beam or the mote, the beam out of your eye. Then you'll see to take the mote out of your brother's. Now do you see that? That's called the frighteners. They just carte blanche say, judge not. Yet the other scriptures will say, make a righteous judgment. Jesus himself said in John 5:30, my judgment is just, translate, innocent, well-meaning, to help. So if I make a judgment on John, it's to help John, not away with him, not watch him slide down into deeper trouble and deeper trouble, because trouble begets trouble. Darkness brings more darkness. It's to help him get up and get, yes, this is what these broadcasts are all about. Retract. Another opportunity of repentance, and praise God for it. What am I to do to judge them also that are without? So you don't judge the sinner man on the street, period. You preach the gospel to him and give him a tract. But them that are without God judges. Therefore put away from amongst yourselves, and you would have had to judge them first before you put them away. You'd have to judge them before you put them away. Do you hear me? You would have God's recommending it today, now in your life. You would have to judge before you put them away. You can't judge on hearsay. There has to be evidence. You say it sounds like a court. It is. And God has officers in the court. He's pastors, evangelists, deacons. He's got his presbytery. He's got his... My friend, listen. Therefore, put away from amongst yourselves. They're in there doing these wicked things. That wicked person, put them out. Once again, you may say, from what you've been taught, that's physical wicked things. Well, he's going to recommend that Jezebel is dealt with, and it cannot be physical because she's dead. Oh, I see. We're going to have to deal with this today. Yes, we are. She is D-E-A-D, dead, a long time. So she cannot be judged, but yet she's being judged. She can't be judged, but she's being judged. Yeah, read it. Well, we will go and read it. Revelation chapter 2. This is so serious. You may think it's hard to hear. It's hard to preach. Try being up here preaching this. When all the church is screaming, he's a false prophet. He's harsh. He's judgmental. He's critical. No. If that's the case, Jesus is one of the worst critics in the world. Because it's him going to speak now. I am going to introduce you to the speech of Jesus Christ. Now here is Jesus' speech. Revelation chapter 2. Well, in verse 19 he says he knows their works, charitable service, faith, patience, the works, the last to be more than the first, notwithstanding. Oh, I don't like to hear that word. Notwithstanding. So you could have all your good stuff, but notwithstanding. I have a few things against thee. And if the Lord has something against us, we ought to at least be glad he's telling us. We can get it fixed. I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest, or thou permitted, thou permittest that woman Jezebel, which called herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants, to commit fornication, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. She didn't go around having fornication classes as to how to do it. To seduce my servants to commit fornication, spiritual adultery, spiritual fornication, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. That's how bad it got. And I give her space to repent. You see, he judged her, and then he did something about the judgment. His love for that period isolated and froze the judgment. I give her a space to repent of her fornication. It's froze now. She's got a space. And this is the kind of love we ought to pray and ask God to help us to grow and cultivate and have this love, that we can give people a space. Be patient and long-suffering, filled with love and carefulness. I give her a space to repent of her fornication. Result, she repented not. She didn't take her opportunity. She didn't walk out in the space. Behold, listen on. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery. I thought she was dead. He is yet to cast her into this bed. Behold, I will. Oh, I see. She's still alive? No. Well, he's talking to her as if she is. But he already cast her when the dogs got her. When Jehu obeyed, and some of you young men and women out there need to obey God and do what he's telling you to tell and telling you what to do. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her in the great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. Now it's plural. Now we have a church. He's writing to a church. What church? The church of Thyatira. Write these things. So Thyatira had a visit from Jezebel, who called herself a prophetess. But like over in Corinthians, when it said, if that person is called a brother and do these things, fornication, covetousness, etc., which is the prosperity movement, put that person out if they be called a brother. But note there it said, if they be called. We've had to have known them in fellowship in the church. That does not mean membership. There's no membership in the church. We are members one of another. There's no pink card signed to membership and 6-week classes to become a member. When you're born again, the day, the hour, and the moment you're born again, you're a member of God's family and members one of each other in particular. Amen to word. Jezebel called herself a prophetess. Over there it said, if a man or a woman be called. So if had you recognized their credentials, what is the credentials? The life they walk. What is that? You'll know them by their fruit. But that's a judgment. Oh, I'm so glad you noticed. Praise the Lord. We're making progress. Amen. You notice that fruit inspecting is judging. And if people would inspect the fruit that people are trying to pass over as Christian fruit, we would have less problems. Thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess. So over in the Corinthian passage, it's saying before they're put out, if they be called a brother. It does not matter one whit a hill of beans that they call themselves a brother. Do you see that? It does not matter that they said, I'm a brother. I'm a sister in the Lord. No, that does not count. It said, if they be called, if they be known to be called, if we know that when we call them a brother, we are vouching for them that they are born again. Now, in this case, she calleth herself a prophetess. We didn't. Now, do you see that? Right there in your scripture as you're following along. Calleth herself. The church has to call her a prophetess. Now, Philip had daughters, which is prophetess. So there's ministry for women in the Bible, prophetess. So we're scriptural enough here. But I can't see women pastors. Just not so. But that's another whole lesson. But don't let that disturb you. There's no women pastors, but there are women prophetesses and women preachers. And I've had the pleasure in my tents as I went to various places of the country to bring a great preaching lady and get her up to preach. It's wonderful. Helps the women enormously to let God bring their ministry forward. I give her a space to repent of her fornication. She repented not. Or adultery. She repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her, them that sit under her teaching, them that buy her books, tapes, and DVDs, and all of that, those that supply her needs and her money and her travel, I will cast them into great, with her, oh, what company, oh, dear Lord of mercy, into great tribulation. Ah, but again, the mercies of God, even them that's upholding her, supporting her to seduce his kids, they are, you are watching and listening, supporting Kenneth Copeland to bring forth heresies and bad teaching and destroying young boys and girls. Shame on you. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. See, even here at the last moment, we're in Revelation, the last book of the Bible, speaking to the churches. Now, these messages to the seven churches are alive. If he was here himself, Jesus, in his long robe, in his synagogue, he would teach this. And he would say something like this. It's in here today. And it's in our churches today. And right now, you're struggling. You can't accept this, but you're in good hands if you're listening to the watchman. I'm a watchman. But the watchman we ought to listen to is the watchman, the Lord Jesus Christ, on the wall, giving his servants advance information, information that's been already distilled amongst the churches, and they're not listening. You think the mainline churches will listen to this? You think the Assemblies of God will listen to this? You think the Church of God will listen to this? You think the Church of God of Prophecy will listen to this? You think the Conic will listen to this? You think, no! That's why they joined the ecumenical movement, to come into the agreement of oneness that's not Christ-like. But there's a blessing in this teaching here, praise God. Yeah, you can get straightened out and retract, that's a blessing. But look at this blessing for saints that are walking straight up. That's allowing God to make them the new lump. That's allowing God, ah yes, behold, if any man be in Christ, I qualify. You qualify? Any man be in Christ, behold! An exclamation, a term, listen up! Behold, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. New creations don't run after bigger is better. Look at this blessing. I will cast her into bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation. Let's pull the word great out. Blackboard. Great tribulation. A race. Great. What do you have? That commit adultery with her into tribulation. Now Jesus promised us in the Gospel of St. John, in this world, it didn't mean being worldly, but in this physical, in this world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. Here he prefixes it with the word back on the board, in the sentence, great tribulation. I will keep you. You'll have regular tribulation, cursing and swearing at you. I've been punched out on the streets of Ipswich, England. Yes, sir, thank God John was there to help and protect me. I'm saying you'll have this kind of tribulation. And they'll badmouth you. They'll cuss you out. But it will be classified as tribulation. Here, the prefix goes on, and it's classified as great tribulation. If she just would have repented, she wouldn't be going into great tribulation. We'll all have tribulation if we have the truth. That's a promise from God. In this world you'll have tribulation, but be of good cheer. But now those that are going into great tribulation didn't obey God. Those that obeyed God, if they repented, they wouldn't be going into the great tribulation with the Jezebel teaching. We'll finish there at verse 23, at least that part, and we'll move to another scripture. 23, I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and the hearts, and I will give unto every one of you according to your works. If you follow the Bless Me Club, the false teaching, the easy believism, you will go that way. And if you follow Christ and you pick up your cross and deny yourself and follow Jesus, you'll go this way. One goes to hell, the other goes to heaven. We've already established in our last teaching, there's no purgatory. That's just a lying wonder. So, my friend, we're going to go back to 2 Corinthians, I think. 2 Corinthians. It's very serious that we get the Word of God preached and taught to us. I need it. We all need it. How many need teaching today? The Word of God lined out. Well, if we can find it. Here we are. 2 Corinthians. And we are in, I think, chapter 6. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Second Corinthians 6:15. Know ye not that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them the members of a harlot? God forbid. Christ's membership in his church, though we are members one of another, there's no joining, there's being saved. I take the members of Christ and make them the members of a harlot? God forbid. What? Know ye not that he which is joined to a harlot is one body? For two saith he shall be one flesh. He that is joined into or unto the Lord is one spirit. Flee fornication. Physical and otherwise. If you go with that crowd, you may not be aware of this afternoon. If you go with that crowd, you're making yourselves members of a harlot. That's the harlot church. You are willfully making yourself members with that. And God does not want you to do that. He said you'll be joined unto the Lord or joined unto a harlot. Again, no middle ground. Be not unevenly yoked together. Wherefore come out from among them and touch not the unclean thing. Amen. Now, I actually feel him in church. I'm saying amen, and I'm just up here in the pulpit. But praise God, I feel his presence. So I'm just acting the way I would in your church. Yes, sir. Now, I want to go to a passage in 2 Corinthians 6:14. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion has light with darkness? A question. What communion, what fellowship, what concord, what spiritual intercourse? Well, now over here, if you had physical intercourse, you would be an adulterer or a fornicator. But here, if you are unevenly yoked and you have wrongful fellowship, you're looked on like a harlot. There's an intercourse of the mind, the spirit, and when you speak, you agree and nod the head. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. You say, well, I'm Baptist, he's Methodist, he's Presbyterian. We don't do that with the Catholic Church. But you go to the mass rallies. Note the word mass. You go to the mass rallies, conventions, super meetings, big conventions. And in there, you're worshiping with the Roman Catholic Church via the Catholic Charismatic Renewal and the Pope. They're his representatives in there, his priests. There's even Monsignors at the top of the list. There's even cardinals, like there was Cardinal Colm, who duped the Protestant believers and brought them into the Catholic Charismatic Renewal. Cardinal Colm. Be not unevenly yoked. What concord is Christ with Belial? What concord or agreement has Christ with the devil? Yet they're all up there worshiping, and now they have to say the Pope saved. You ever known a Pope to bear salvation? All those who say they're Catholic, they talk about purgatory and masses and scapulars and prayers to the dead. Yes, prayers to the dead. They have no assurance of salvation. The Roman Catholic Church does not ever preach assurance of salvation by the blood wiping out and away your sin. They preach all have sinned. Why, that's part of our message. All have sinned. They go through purgatory to be purged and cleansed, to be made, I quote, fit and proper to go to heaven. Show that to me in this Bible. Show that. Right here. Bring your Bible here and put it alongside that. Bring your Bible with purgatory. If it is, I'll eat this one. I'll leave time. There is none in here or in your St. Joseph's Catholic edition. Now, to make a statement, you have to prove it, even in a natural physical court. To prove it, you must bring the literature. The judge examines both, and so does the jury. Here, the pastor, the elders, the regular believers, all of them, judge it. What concord has Christ with Belial, the Catholic Church? What part does he believeth with an infidel? If you go to those meetings, you attended a Catholic meeting, though it was mixed, and you're as mixed up as they are, you need delivered, and God loves you. And we're reaching this halfway point now where we can say quite categorically, Jesus died for you, he loves you, and he will bring you again back. If you will but acknowledge